Welcome to the Financial Planning for Canadian Business Owners podcast. You will hear about industry insights with award-winning financial planner and entrepreneur, Jason Pereira. Through the interviews with different experts with their stories and advice, you will learn how you can navigate the challenges of being an entrepreneur, plan for success, and make the most of your business and life. And now, your host, Jason Pereira.
Hello and welcome. Today on the show, I have Vic Gasparich. Vic is a lawyer that specifically practices in the area of real estate in various forms. And in particular, he's been raising the flag about problems with the new Ontario professional real estate corporations and issues with the act that made these things come true. There are some real concerns around the tax status of these. And Vic is the more or less the lone gunman out there that's warning people about what's going on. And I brought him on the show to have this conversation. So with that, here's my interview with Vic. Vic, thanks for coming on.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So Vic Gasparich, tell us a little bit about who you are.
Lawyer of private practice. I'm a sole practitioner carrying on under a professional corporation. I practice in downtown Toronto. I share a space with a litigation law firm. I'm a corporate lawyer, as I said. The bulk of my practice involves the real estate brokerage industry, not real estate. I don't touch real estate. I'd be sued, but the brokerage industry itself. I do have a significant amount of involvement there. The litigators I'm involved with, Gil Mulholland, Neil Gill in particular, he does a huge amount of work with RICO on the defense side, defending complaints that RICO brings against agents.
Okay. So needless to say,
I've set up numerous brokerage firms across the province and set up a lot of them.
So basically what it comes down to, when I said you were in real estate, wasn't really doing you justice. Basically, the average real estate lawyer, as we think of it, typically closes on deals. You are more on the, for lack of a better term, industry infrastructure side. You basically have a long history of the business of real estate brokerage and sales.
Yeah, that's correct.
So I brought you on the show because we were connected by Christine Brunson, who's a fellow colleague of both of ours, when she raised the flag on there being serious problems with the new Ontario professional real estate corporation. So first off, before we get into what the problems are, let's talk about what these corporations are, what they were intended to do. What is it that people think these things are?
Well, let me first of all say it's not a professional real estate corporation, personal real estate corporation.
My bad.
No, there's a huge difference there, big legal difference.
Yeah.
The intent was that it be a professional real estate corporation. The intent was that the professional corporation would be permitted to be registered under the Real Estate and Business Brokers Act as a PC, being able to trade in real estate. The intent was that realtors could use a professional corporation the same way I do, the same way doctors, dentists, and so on do. The same way is done in British Columbia, okay? Under our professional corporation is defined under the Business Corporations Act as a corporation incorporated under the Act or carried on under the Act, and which is allowed by the Act that governs its industry to issue a certificate of authorization to carry on business as a professional corporation. In the Law Society Act, I get a certificate of authorization every couple of years, I guess. Same thing with, again, doctors, dentists, and so on. That is not the case here. What we have here, now, let me go back a step. There was an act about 3 years ago called the Tax Fairness to Realtors Act. And it was put forward by members of the private members bill. All three parties supported it, went to committee. It died in committee when the last election was called. It would have done exactly what they wanted it to do. It created a professional real estate corporation. It basically said the corporation could do nothing but trade in real estate, could do nothing but act as a brokerage. That, unfortunately, died in the order paper. Okay. Had that gone through, we wouldn't be having this discussion today.
Fair enough. So that bill was kosher. It was in line with the precedents established elsewhere in other jurisdictions and other industries. Yeah. So that didn't happen. What happened?
Now, we've got changes that were made to the Act that provided for the creation of a personal real estate corporation. What is that? It's a corporation of which the controlling shareholder must be an agent or broker registered with a brokerage. Okay, it must be the sole holder of the equity shares, basically, controlling shareholder. It's the sole officer and director of the personal real estate corporation. The big difference is, what can a PREC, a personal real estate corporation, do? Well, it can do everything. It can do anything except it cannot trade in real estate. It cannot hold out to be a brokerage. It cannot be a brokerage. The PREC, its controlling shareholders, officers, directors, employees, are expressly prohibited from suggesting that the PREC is anybody involved in the real estate business. So it's got nothing to do with real estate. Nothing but to do. What does the PREC do? Theoretically, this is where this makes no sense. The controlling shareholder has to be registered under the Real Estate and Business Brokers Act with a brokerage. So what the PREC does, the business of the PREC, is to make the services of its controlling shareholder available to the brokerage. Well, I'm sorry, but that makes no sense.
Let me take a stop on that for a second. Is there even a precedent for that? I've never seen that, right? Typically, the actions of an employee and an owner are separate under law in the concept of corporations, right? I have never seen something that basically says you have access to a shareholder, right? Like, if anything, corporations are designed to separate shareholders from the corporations for liability purposes.
Yep. No, I agree, Jordan. So the business of the PREC is to make the services of its controlling shareholder available to be an agent or a salesperson or broker with a brokerage. Well, you're not doing anything that doesn't already exist. That is the current state of being. Your controlling shareholder is already an agent. It's a total failure of consideration here. Okay. Yeah. You're doing something that's already been done. Now, in return for that, the brokerage pays you money. The amount of money it pays you happens to be equivalent to the commissions that the agent would make, but they don't call it commissions anymore. They call it remuneration. But what is it? The closest thing to an activity that the PREC carries on is it's a placement firm, it's a placement agency. It places one person with the brokerage, and in return for which it gets paid a fee, a service fee. That's the best argument that can be made. It doesn't get paid the commissions, it's paid the commission that the agent would have made, but it's a service fee. It's not commission income to the PREC, because the PREC is not in the sales business, okay? So we've got a breakdown there. First breakdown is that, again, it doesn't make sense. It makes absolutely no sense because, again, it doesn't do anything that doesn't already exist. The problem we now have, the problem that the agent now has is, okay, I've got a PREC and I've got my independent contractor agreement in place with my brokerage, but the money I'm making now, I would have made, is now being paid as a service fee to my PREC for making me available to the brokerage. Cool. Now, I'm a hotshot agent and I've got to make it easy. I've got $50,000 of sales expenses this year. My car, my signage, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, my client dinners. I get 50 grand in legitimate write-offs, but you know what? I've got no income to write it off against.
Because it's not commission income.
My income has gone to the PREC. What the agents tell me was, that's not a problem. I'll transfer my expenses to the PREC. Well, no, I'm sorry. How do you transfer your legitimate sales expenses to the PREC? The PREC is not in the sales business. You can't use them.
Right. And you incurred those in your personal name. And you did so as a factor of the fact that you're working on behalf of the brokerage firm, which is another party.
Under an independent contract agreement, yeah, which is all fine. Yeah. So you've got the legitimate expenses that you now cannot write off anymore. Okay.
So you can't write those off. One of the things that when I brought this to the attention of a certain brokerage firm that not shall be mentioned, was, well, that's not a problem. If you're worried about that, you can just issue yourself a T4A from the PREC. Care to address that issue?
It doesn't apply.
Exactly.
It just doesn't apply. It makes no sense.
Well, I mean, the T4As are typically are self-employment income, typically commission or otherwise, flowed through from a corporation to an individual that allows them to deduct expenses. But again, if that person is not employed by the corporate, by the PREC, acting as a commissioned agent for the PREC, then you can't issue the T4A.
Exactly. You are employed by the PREC. You're an officer of the PREC, but the PREC is not
in a commission. Business. Yeah, exactly.
No commission's involved. You are not paid a commission as an officer. Yeah. So
the only solution that I've been given alternatively this is, that solution basically also has this entire massive gray or black area of don't do it in tax law.
Oh, no, absolutely. Absolutely. There's a breakdown here in corporate law. There's a breakdown here in tax law. Like, the way I see the PREC, it's an attempt basically to divert what would otherwise be personal income coming to the agent, personal income, tax to personal income level, is an attempt to divert it to a corporate entity, which is a Canadian-controlled private corporation entitled to small business deduction. But it's an attempt to divert it, but it doesn't work. It's not a legitimate way to convert your sales income into something there. It doesn't work.
Well, it's not so much that, again, if this has been done as a proper professional corporation, like we've crossed this bridge many, many times before. This is not something that hasn't been done before. It's that this bill has managed to create almost a new classification of corporation without trying, that has no precedent in tax law that permits it to operate with the way that the real estate agents think it does. So that's the structural issue. Talk about the actual practicality of money getting paid, right? So basically, the other alternative that was brought up was, well, can't they just split the income between the corporation and themselves?
Well, that's an interesting point, because the regulations that are created does contemplate and does permit money to be paid to both the agent and to the PREC. Okay, it does permit that. It contemplates it. So in that particular case, if an agent knows he's going to have 50 grand in legitimate write-offs, let him take 50 grand plus whatever personally. The rest can be paid to the PREC as a service fee to the PREC for providing, making him available as a placement company, as a placement agency. The problem with that, and it's not a legal problem, the problem, and I've discussed this with a number of large brokerages. I act for a number of them, but some other ones I don't act for. The problem is everybody uses the lone wolf accounting system, okay?
Which is a software, to be clear.
The software. The software does not permit commission to be allocated between an individual and that individual's PREC.
The single outflow. It's got to go to one source.
Right, or the other, yeah. Now, the problem still exists. That deals with the matter of the agent not having any income against which he can write off expenses. That does not deal with the larger issue, which is that the whole thing is a sham.
This is true. So, I mean,
it's a fictitious company.
It's a type of thing that shouldn't exist because it doesn't really exist under corporate law. So, and we'll get to that opinion in a second. But I already had one of these set up long before we ever met for a client of mine. And I mean, the quote unquote simple yet less than elegant solution is that the brokerage firm is going to have to agree to flip the switch from PREC to personal payment for a period of time and then maybe back. And that's suboptimal in so many ways, right? First of all, it creates no, I'm sure the agencies don't want to be doing that for every one of their agents. That's just a major pain.
Yeah, absolutely.
Secondly, there's the timing of cash flows, right? So it's 100% of the commission coming to them with no discretion as to how much. So you can have a big deal, small deal, whatever it is, right? So now I'm trying to flip a switch at a point in the future, which may take me beyond an income that I actually wanted them to pay to the client in the first place. So it becomes I don't know that I can flip this switch in the most tax efficient way possible.
Yeah, there's that problem. And again, there's also the problem of the software system that doesn't allow you to do it.
Well, it doesn't allow you to split between two, but it allows you to go whole the one to the other. So that's the problem.
It's all one or the other. Yes, it's all one or the other. Yeah. Either the agent gets paid under the independent contractor agreement, or it gets paid as remuneration to the PREC for theoretically making you available to the brokerage firm, which again is nonsense because you are already an independent contractor engaged by and registered with the brokerage firm. Yeah. So the PREC isn't doing anything new. There's no consideration.
So, I mean, there's some of the kind of two aspects of this, because you mentioned this. So it's a breakdown of corporate law. It's a breakdown of tax law. So from a corporate law standpoint, the entire bizarre nature of this thing not being a sales corporation, that it is licensing access to the shareholder, not the employee of the firm, to the brokerage. And on top of that, it is also receiving, is basically like that relationship pre-existed already. Exactly. This is all just a head scratcher, like quite honestly.
Exactly. And that's why it's nothing but an attempt to, again, divert taxable income into a corporate entity, which gets a small business deduction. Yeah. And situations like that, I mean, CRA has crapped on those kinds of things in the past.
Well, that's the tax aspect. Let's go. So from the structure aspect, we know this is a bit of a mess, right? And it's not that the concept of having your professional income money go into a corporation to access a small business deduction rate is a problem.
If it's a professional real estate corporation, absolutely not.
Correct.
Every lawyer does it. Every doctor, every dentist does it. It's allowed. It's permissible.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's not the act of having it paid to a corporation, although some anti-corporation people may basically think otherwise. It's really trying to respect the fact that these people are technically self-employed individuals who did not have the right to incorporate previously. But instead of going down the road of creating the proper following the properly blessed structure of this, something new and, for lack of a better term, half-baked was basically conceived of that now we have a tax problem, and we have a tax problem on multiple levels. So you hit upon the first one. This was done by the province of Ontario. Yep. The federal government has got no incentive to bless this thing or let it be, right? Because, hey, if the feds screw up something in the tax bill, they could tap on CRA shoulder and say, hey, we kind of screwed something up. Maybe just let people let it go, right? Like that's been known to happen. But for the provinces to do that with CRA, they've got no pull. So CRA is already established precedent for, hey, this is a, for lack of a better term, access to the small business tax rate scheme without a legitimate enterprise relationship. Yeah. Goodbye. Like that's what they just typically laugh at you and say, well, here's your normal tax bill. So that's the first problem. So they're in danger there, right? And then when we sum up the tax standpoint issues, it is they're in danger of having the small business deduction disallowed in the first place. Now, that could be a, that is, you know, depending on some of the agents I know, my goodness, like being told, expecting a tax bill and filing a tax bill at X and then getting that done and magnitude, like we're talking like what, 12.5% versus 53.53,
oh, yeah,
right? 4X what you were expecting. I mean, oh my God, it's enough to make someone have a heart attack. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, can you even deduct your legitimate business expenses anymore because of the nonsense of this? And the third is, like, here's the other thing too, is that besides you being the lone wolf basically out there, not to quote the accounting system, but you're the lone voice basically screaming into the night about this at this point. And there's going to be more, we just discussed this, more coming out about this in the near future. But a lot of people, how many of these things were set up? I mean, like, you had some stats on that.
Well, yeah, the last stat I got was about 3 weeks ago. Now, remember, with a PREC, all you are required to do is notify RICO, the Real Estate Council of Ontario, which is the governing body. All you have to do is notify the PREC. I have created a PREC. Here's the name of the PREC, and here's the address for service. And that's it. No more. Okay? So RICO has no further involvement. The last number I got was about 3 weeks ago. They had had, 4,700 notifications.
There you go. 4,700 notifications. So we're approaching 5,000 realtors in this province alone.
I suspect right now it's over 5, yeah.
Yeah, so over 5,000 realtors who think they've done something very wise from a tax planning standpoint. Yeah. They went to their lawyers and set this corporation. The lawyers set it up because, hey, lawyers are not one to question by default, is this bill even legitimate? Right? They are like, okay, we know that there's some things we got to follow. We'll do that. They set up the corporation and they're thinking that they're going to save and they're setting up the accounting systems and they're thinking they're going to save a bundle of tax and they could be in for a very rude awakening come next year when they get their tax bill.
Well, what I've done, when I've been approached, I've always insisted the conversation take place with the client's accountant present.
Yeah.
Okay. And with a couple of exceptions, invariably the accountant has said, do not be the guinea pig. Let's just write it out, see what happens.
Yeah.
Stay as you are. There are a few that have gone ahead. Jason, you've received my talking papers from a presentation I did a while ago. And the clients, they get those. Okay. I send it to them. Here are my concerns. The accountant gets them. Here are my concerns. And as I said, the accountant invariably said, no, back off. Do not be a guinea pig. Let somebody else take the pain.
And let's throw some more credibility behind this. This isn't
a lot of accountants close to see. The reality is I could have set up a ton of these, a ton of money and fees, but not doing it. Okay.
There you go. Yeah, you're talking yourself out of money. So let's just add some more credibility to this. This is not just you who said this. Like, you've taken this opinion, you've gotten your opinion confirmed. Who else has basically looked at your view and said, Vic, you got this right?
There are some other lawyers that I've dealt with that agree entirely. There are accounting firms, Grant Thornton, for one, Fuller Landau. Okay, they're major accounting firms dealing with the tax experts in both those firms. Fuller Landau acts for my largest client. And, you know, they're the view that they agree with me. The gentleman over at Grant Thornton, again, also in agreement. Once they've analyzed, these are real risks. You know, I may be wrong, okay, but these are real risks and we can't answer them. And they share the exact same concerns. Some other accounting firms in different parts of the province that some lawyers have come to me and I've passed my opinion on. But again, like I said, we're probably over 5,000 registrations right now. Agents are so anxious to proceed with this. They just will not listen. I've had agents getting arguments over, well, as you said, the government wouldn't do this. The government wouldn't pass something that's not going to...
Well, no, so that's the common... So the first one was, I doubt very much that the government would ever pass a bill that had this kind of law thinking to it. And I've been around long enough and dealt with tax long enough and other regulatory stuff long enough to know that that is a very funny statement. There is plenty of precedent that shows that they do that all the time. Yep. I will go back to the small business tax fairness stuff that they were trying to pass several years ago, which was just utter bonkers lunacy. And countless, I sit back and with my legal and accounting friends, we could sit back and have a couple of drinks and reminisce about the days of lobbying over stupid crap that should never have been tabled in the first place. And unfortunately, a lot of people take a lot of solace in the government getting things right, yet at the same time seem to think government's incompetent. I don't understand the duality of that nature. But the point is that you can't take that response, that action, because at the end of the day, you're the liability. Like, you're taking liability. Like, so I know, like, I would say the word of advice that I think you'll probably echo is, if someone's already set one of these things up, just know that you may not save a penny on this, at least right now. Something's going to have to be done, because with over 5,000 of these things set up, right, and more every day, guaranteed, like, there's going to be a lot of outcry from these people if it's not fixed. But we might have a year or two where it's not fixed and you're on the hook. And it's more so the shock, right? It's one thing, you know, fair is fair. You tell me that, hey, you set the corporation, something's not quite right. Like, we're going to try to fix this. We might not get to it in the year. Like, no one's going to be happy with that. So getting that notice of assessment from CRA saying disallowed all of this stuff and you owe us X, wow.
Why would CRA cooperate with correcting something? This has been their position all along. And we're not saying anything that CRA hasn't done before. This is a common position they've always taken on these kinds of issues. There's nothing shocking.
Hey, I mean, there's an old saying, if they had their choice, they'd tax everything.
They're not going to accommodate the Ontario Conservative government, you know, and changing the tax laws. It's just not going to happen. So the unfortunate thing, I emphasize, had the original plan gone through, the original act, again, we wouldn't be talking today.
So let's talk about that. That act, which actually handled this properly and made it a professional corp, not a personal corp. Talk to me about, like, you know, why did that not go through?
Well, first of all, they call it the Tax Fairness for Realtors Act, which was pure lunacy and idiocy. Who gives a damn about tax fairness to realtors?
Realtors.
Okay. Realtors, yes. Who else? What motivation is there for legislators, okay, to put that through? Beyond that, I don't know. The
lobbying.
The bill died, like I said, it sat in committee for 3-4 months, whatever, 5 months, didn't it? It didn't get dealt with. And then the bridge was dropped and went the election, and that was the end of it. Why? I have my theories on why.
Fair enough. One of the things we discussed, we'll leave the political ones out of this, but I mean, one of the things that we discussed previously was that if you have a professional corp structure, you need to have a bureaucracy to basically police that, right?
That's why. Here's the thing. Real Estate Council of Ontario is the body that regulates the industry. I work with the side that does the registrations. They're really good people over there, okay? They are working their asses off. They're all working from home still. They are behind. They are working like crazy to get stuff done, okay? Like I said, the other side, the one that Neil works with, again, I don't work with that side, but my side, the people that I send stuff to for registrations and that kind of stuff, they're phenomenal people. They're great. They work their butts off. But you know what? They don't have enough of them. They're overworked, okay? So, as I said, there is no registration process. Just notification to RICO that, hey, this is a PREC. Here's the address for service. That's the end of it.
I mean, I don't get it. I mean,
a registration system.
Yeah.
Because the government would have had to have poured a ton of money into RICO to hire the people to be able to do it and manage it. This is not a
isn't this, I mean, to me, this is different. I look at things like, I get this the way government looks at things, but sometimes, but to me, it's like, you want this? No problem. Guess what, realtors? You're paying for it. Right? Like, to me, that would be it. It'd be like, oh, Oria, you want this? You're funding the actual development of this. And then your agents pay an annual fee to basically maintain the bureaucracy. But again, depending on who you talk to, they don't necessarily want more government bureaucracy in any way, shape, or form. So, yeah. I mean, what a genius solution I have for a problem that shouldn't exist in the first place. But, you know, it is what it is. So, okay. So,
the bureaucracy to do 5,000 registrations, then monitor them, then do annual or biannual rules on them, and so on and so forth. Massive bureaucracy. They can do it in BC because it's a lot smaller real estate population, a lot fewer realtors, okay, than Ontario.
Yeah, just as far as I'm concerned, if they want access to it, charge them for it. That's me. But anyway, let's wrap this up with a couple of things, two things. So, I think your advice is summed up. If you haven't set one of these things up, don't. Right? Like, that's basically your advice at this point.
Oh, right now. Okay. Yep. Wait and see what happens.
If you have set one of these things up, you have two choices. Choice A is leave it alone. Let's let the corporation sit there, file your zero return, wait for it to get fixed, and keep doing what you were doing previously, right?
Yep.
And the third choice comes down to, if you want to take the chance that you can get access to small business deduct tax rate, then you're going to have to flip that switch, right? From personal to corporate and maybe back. And be a nuisance to your agency. But that's really your only choice, right? Those are your only three choices. Either just don't play the game or play the game and hope it works out well.
Yeah.
But either way, you know that you're going to be probably no worse off from a tax standpoint, but you'll be worse off from an administrative and setup standpoint.
Yeah. And the third option is, again, it's a nightmare. You've got two things going against you. A, flipping a switch by the brokerage. Like I said, right now, they will not do it because of the software they use. They say they cannot do it, and you still.
Well, they can. I pushed them on that, so don't accept that necessarily. They may not want to.
Okay, tell me about that later. That's great. But the other problem is still, again, the attempt to divert income, which otherwise personal income, into a corporate entity with there's no basis for doing it.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, like, at the end of the day, you're taking the chance. Well, a very possible, very probable chance. The CRA says, "What is this thing? And what is it you mean that you get to pay 12.5%? No, thank you. That's not it, right? So again, from a tax standpoint, you could end up no better off. They could just be like, yeah, that money, that's yours. That's not the corpse, that's yours. Cut us a check for the difference, right?
So and from that standpoint, interest in fines too. That's, you know.
Well, potentially, yeah. We'll see how that goes. So it is what it is. So yeah, so I mean, that's rough. So good news is I'm helping you get the message out there about these. Please keep doing what you're doing, because there's a lot of people going to pay a lot of, again, if people are doing things that they think are according to the rules and fair play, and they get smacked in the mouth for it because the bill, they couldn't be bothered to pass the bill that basically was actually going to take care of the problem properly. That ain't right. Like that's what no one signed up for. So is what it is. So Vic, if anyone wants to find you and to discuss this in greater detail, where can they find you?
Phone number 416-804-2880. That's my cell phone. That's basically on 7 days a week. Vic@GasparichPC.com.
Excellent. Vic, thank you so much for this. And thank you
my
for
pleasure.
The duty
thank
you're
you.
Doing to basically get this message out.
Okay, guy. Talk to you later.
So that was my interview with Vic Gasparich about the personal real estate corporations. As you can see, it's a bit of a gong show. So again, if you haven't gone down this road, maybe wait. If you have gone down this road, tread with caution, either opt out or just know that you could basically end up paying the same or more when you factor in penalties. So it is what it is. This is the message we're just trying to get out there. And I hope you are, if you know, you are someone if you as a listener or someone you know is affected by this, please share this recording so that they're more informed. As always, if you enjoyed this podcast, please leave a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or whatever's your podcast. And until next time, take care.
This podcast was brought to you by Woodgate Financial, an award-winning financial planning firm catering to high net worth individuals, business owners, and their families. To learn more, go to woodgate.com. You can subscribe to this podcast on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Google Play, and Spotify, or find more episodes at jasonpereira.ca. You can even ask Siri, Alexa, or Google Home to subscribe for you.